My mother thought I worked for the Ministry of Ag and Fish. She died at almost 80 without ever knowing the truth, and she wasn't the only one, because all those who worked for the Special Operations Executive, Churchill's Secret Army, that army which he created in July 1940 to set fire, to set the New World ablaze, were under the Official Secrets Act, and it wasn't until 2000, after 60 years, that SOE files were opened to the public. And immediately the media pounced on we few survivors who were still upright, more or less. And one of the questions they said, well, who recruited you? Why were you recruited? Who proposed you? I'd really like to know. Even after all these years, I haven't the faintest idea who recruited me or why. I was a pupil at the French Lycée in London, but at the ripe old age of 17, 18, I was obliged to leave my studies. I received my call-out papers, either join the armed forces or work in the munitions factory. Well, the latter option did not appeal to me, so I decided to become a Wren, join Women's Royal Naval Force, because I liked the hat. I thought it was terribly seductive. But when I went to enlist, a vinegar-faced woman told me they only had vacancies for cooks and stewards. Although that really wasn't the Mata Hari image I'd wanted to present to the waiting world, and it was certainly not the way I intended to lead my country to victory. Making stew and slip puddings, no. So I declined. That caused a bit of a rumpus. And finally, they sent me to the Foreign Office, where I was closeted in a kind of windowless broom cupboard with an army officer who began shooting questions at me, ducking backwards and forwards between English and French like a demented kangaroo. He seemed very surprised that I was able to keep up. He sent me to tell me to go to 64 Baker Street. Well, where is this building? But like the haunts of people who pass by it every day, never had I realised or even imagined that this was, in fact, the headquarters of Churchill's Secret Army. I doubt whether I even knew that such an army existed. The colonel who received me, well, he must have approved of me, because he told me to go to a certain Captain Miller, who he said was expecting me. Well, he may have been. But when I arrived, he'd forgotten. He stared at me as if I'd just dropped in from outer space, and then suddenly barked, "Nobody, but nobody must know what you do here, not your mother, your father, your sister, your brother, your fiancé." Well, I never discovered who else wasn't supposed to know, because at that moment an immensely tall Irish Guards officer burst into the room like a bomb, making peculiar squeaking sounds. And the two of them roared off down the corridor. I later learned that they had both just returned from the field, which was the code name for enemy territory. Everything was in code. And that the Irishman, when escaping, had been shot in the throat, which had turned him into a ventriloquist doll. But that afternoon, I was unaware of all these details. I was totally bewildered. I thought I was going into the Navy, but there wasn't a sailor in sight. And I was beginning to be seriously concerned about when I was going to get my seductive hat. I thought that I had been trapped in a kind of hyperactive lunatic asylum run by the crazy gang. That was the impression it gave. There was a girl slightly older than I, Fanny. She was busy picking up all the papers they'd sent flying, and I turned to her and I said, "It's always like this here." "Oh no," she reassured me. "It's usually worse."